It's not just radio, it's Rockland World Radio. RocklandWorldRadio.com.
Welcome to Voice of Reason, a weekly report and discussion on the important issues of concern on the local, national, and global stage. And now, the host and moderator of Voice of Reason, Dan Giordano.
Hello, and welcome to the Voice of Reason. I'm joined by my regular panelists, Paul Tappenden, the Rockland Forager, and Sherwood Martinelli, Renaissance Man of Rockland. Our first topic today is going to be fake news. Fake news, how is it defined? Who's defining it? In the wake of the Facebook outrage after the election about fake news sites, who they're leaning towards, where they're coming from, we want to try to talk about this and frame the issue. We want to talk about how does this issue get refined and resolved, and what are people doing currently to fix the problem. So I'll toss it out to you first, Paul.
I don't know if they want to fix the problem. I mean, fake news has been on the go for years now. I mean, certainly as long as I can remember listening to the news, it's been fake news going, you know. It's just that the major corporations, you know, they had the whole line on fake news for years, and now all of a sudden, with the alternative websites out there, now there's such an expanse on what news is that it's making them very nervous. A lot of what I've seen called fake news is anything but. It's people trying to find the truth behind the lies of the news. So it's a very difficult thing to try to define. I know that, for instance, Google and Facebook, they're going to now define what is news and what is fake. And Google, in particular, intends to push a lot of the current website down into the depths so that we can't find them anymore, because they consider that they're fake news sources.
And so I think you think they're using algorithms to control that already? Because I don't believe they're actually even addressing it.
I'm not sure if algorithms even come into this. I mean, I think most of this is political, to be honest with you.
Right.
I mean, they got pissed as hell when Trump won, and they decided that they would blame the alternative media that was in support of Trump, a lot of it. And I'm not saying that fake news doesn't exist everywhere, it's just that they really are attacking some of the wrong areas, as far as I'm concerned, but that's up to them.
Sherwood, do you think that there's a way to define what is fake news and fake news? I know you have that.
I think we're sort of getting a little ahead of ourselves, okay? We literally had what's called a perfect storm, okay? And I think we have to start really looking into where all this news comes from. Did some of it come from Russia? Absolutely. Were they trying to push fake news stories and or stories they thought they would be good for Trump? Yes, they did. Okay, but then in addition to that, you have people that are looking to grow their follower base, for instance, on Twitter. A perfect for instance of that was, I don't know if you remember the story when supposedly right after the election, the Democratic Party was paying protesters to protest down in Austin, Texas. Well, it turns out that a gentleman by the name of Eric Tucker, okay, who is co-founder of a marketing company who had 40 Twitter followers at the time, was merely looking for a way to kind of grow his base, and he saw all these buses a couple of blocks from the protesters and threw a tweet out that was retweeted 16,000 times.
That's going to create
that created fake news.
Well, let me ask you a question, because I know just from my experience in broadcast, which is limited, that the Twitter feed has become de rigueur in most newsrooms. It's part of the way the news is now created. So I guess a savvy person could try to sensationalize something to get themselves hits. Now, how would we be able to prevent something like that or weed out things? Like I've seen recently, people are creating their own add-ons for browsers.
The best thing that I've seen, and I'll give you a quick real example, is for instance, the Macedonian town of Valise, okay? So campaign is a way to make a whole lot of money with fake news. They were launching websites. One 16-year-old kid was getting over a million hits a day. Doing it because they wanted to affect the election. They actually tried it first with Bernie Sanders, and then they tried it. They weren't getting the click hits that they need to make money. Then they tried Trump, and really helped solve the issue. Is Google is going to start disallowing these kinds of folks to participate in the pay-to-click programs. That financial the ability for these people to turn fake news into a huge financial reward. You know, so I'm wondering what you
It depends on who's defining what is fake. That's the trouble, you see. I mean, it's very much political. It's very much a case of you know, quietening down the opposition. So, and it's going to remain full of crap no matter what you do, you know? So, trying to waste your time going after crap, I think, is ridiculous. It's a waste of everybody's time.
This show notwithstanding.
This show notwithstanding, yeah. I mean, come on. For this show. And I go down so many... There's a lot of stuff out there that's really irrelevant, and it's just people writing for the sake of writing, and a lot of it is absolutely... political bias lined with lies, no matter what side you're looking at. You know, you can't blame one side or the other.
That's true. I have a question off of that for you, because I know you know some programming things. There are a number of people who are developing these add-on that filter these things. And those are independent people. They could be just like anybody else. How would somebody execute a plugin, which is what it's actually called, in a browser, to organize it? Like, how would they cascade the information so that it could be us? Say it was our news sources that somebody was using for their plugin.
I see those plugins of having little value, and here's why. You're on your telephone, and you're on Twitter. And you see a tweet with a link to a news story that interests you, and you click on that link on your telephone, you're not actually going through the traditional pathways you would if you were on Safari or if you were on an actual internet browser. Okay, so it's like unless I'm actually, say, on my computer or I'm on a browser on my phone looking for news stories, that add-on isn't necessarily going to be tripped to identify me to me that that's
one of the things I did read, and we're going to take a quick break, is certain news items that you might click on or your website, your browser might bring up are unverified, and they're one using a host of chain constantly up. Yeah. Is something like that even make sense? But before you answer, let's take a quick break and we'll be right back on the Voice of Reason.
Hey, Michael.
Yeah?
Do you remember when my character Ella says she gave up texting and driving? I wish more people would do the same.
Tell me about it. TWD, texting while driving, not cool. Do you know how many near misses I've had lately because people are trying to blast off a quick text while they're behind the wheel?
Yeah, and I love texting just as much as anybody, but it can wait until I am parked, because no text is worth being distracted and putting lives at risk.
A recent study just found that those who text while driving are 23 times more likely to be involved in an accident.
So, join us and our fellow castmates on Melrose Place, along with AT&T, in saying texting and driving, it can wait.
To learn more about the risks of texting and driving, sign the BFF Pledge and get safe driving tips at facebook.com/AT&T. I'm signing it.
To answer your question, I think we have to be careful about several things, and we have to look at people like Mark Zuckerberg, who, for instance, has pretty much said he will not enforce TOS violations against anything involving Donald Trump, because even if the story's fake, the fact that he's the president-elect makes any story about him fake or otherwise news. So that to me is a huge problem. The other problem you run into is a big part of what is spreading fake news is profit motive by college students, by some guy in his apartment with a beer belly trying to figure out how to make money for his next right. six-pack.
But let me ask you a quick question about that. Is that any different? That's just the little guy doing what the big guys are doing, is it not? I mean, Paul, what do you think real quick? Because I know you have an opinion about that.
Well, you know, it's a big world out there, and there's a lot of people vying for a piece of the pie, as it were.
Exactly.
So, you know, for instance, I have a website. Not only do I not put anything, not website, well, I do have a website, but that page that I don't believe in. That I suspect might not be true, but I tend to only write about stuff that I really know, that I've explored myself and I know what I'm talking about. There's a whole mess of people out there that really don't care whether there's truth or not in what they say. It's just a matter that it sounds effective, it's a way of making money.
So let me ask Sherwood, do you think that there's a way for us to circumnavigate the money? Like the old days, the news divisions, when there was just three networks, they were not making money. And that was always known because they needed to have a wide spread and reach for their reportage. And they also knew that they had to be unbiased and fair in their work. So they were never working for profit. Now, I know in this new era and the internet, that has all changed. How do we put that back in the box and go back to these old standards in a giant global world?
I don't know that you can. In other words, you know, we could go clear back to one of our other shows when we were talking about commodification. The fact of the matter is we have commodified the news and the fake news. The Russians were very smart. They would put these news stories out there that they wanted to gin up. And they would make sure they put them in places where these little guys who were just looking to make a buck would pick them up, cut and paste them, embolden the headline even a little bit more, and then put them back up. And the next thing you know, a fake news story put out by some little Russian troll is now being retweeted, you know, 2 million times. And so that's the problem is as long as you have a little guy trying to feed his family or get another six-pack of beer or a bottle of Dewars, I don't know that you can stop it.
So you're saying unless the economy and, unless there's more equitable distribution of economy, we can't have
or
the truth?
Or you have to
is
be
that,
so... Or,
no, you can't
or,
because...
Or is
because
he talking sobriety? I mean...
No, what I'm talking about here is, look everybody...
Our director, Richard.
Everybody in the lower and the lower middle class are struggling just to pay their bills. And so they're looking for any means they can find to bring in a couple extra dollars. Well, one of the ways that they've found is putting out fake news. They go out, they throw up a website, they make it look somewhat plausible and realistic, and they start putting these stories up. Then they use social media. They get a Facebook page to go with their website. They get a Twitter account to go with their website. They start following a few right people. They start putting a story out there, and they start pushing it to people they know already are rabid, foaming of the mouth, alt-right idiots. Okay, and they pick it up and run with it. And then these people, because they want to reward this person for bringing a story out, click on their Google links to go see a two-second commercial so that this little guy out here in Macedonia suddenly is making, you know, $6,000, $7,000, $8,000, $10,000 a year, which is much more than the average citizen there earns in a year.
Okay, so if we're looking at an open market to define and refine these things, wouldn't it stand to reason that, like, I'll put it to you, Paul. Say I told you... my friend's a programmer and he made incredible news sourcing, even the news source file. You should plug it in, it'll good, so you could actually give it some trust. Mm-hmm. Would that be something you would use and say, okay, well, my buddy told me. Would that be a way? Because the people, there is people.
Yeah. I mean, let's face it. I mean, you know, any tool that helps you sort out the wheat from the chaff is going to be of use.
Right, and now to Sherwood, though, yeah. I would say, wouldn't programmers suddenly try to market their plug-in? And there would be some that would be biased.
If you look at shows like Jerry Springer,
right?
The reality
Jerry
of it
Springer.
Is,
no, he's hitting me with Springer.
A lot of people nowadays, okay, by the millions and millions, they're far more interested in how many followers they have on their Twitter account, how many likes they're getting, and whether we like it or not, we live in a society where it's bam, you know, it's like what will grab people's attention. And so because
that
of it
goes to economy because people do get paid for their
it's not only just economy. What I'm also saying is people will sit there and they will put something controversial or false or fake on their Twitter feed or their Facebook, even though they know it's false, because it's going to get them 20 more likes, or it's going to get them like 3 new followers, or it's going to get them 17 retweets. It's everybody trying to grasp their little teeny tiny 2 minutes of fame, figuring that if they can do that 8 times, they got 16 minutes of fame instead of 15.
Right, but if Paul has the good plug-in, and he's a public figure talking on issues, and he's checking his facts, don't you think those things would be exposed and overcome just the way any old journalist would? And then it becomes journalists kind of policing journalists, citizens journalists, trying to point out when people are wrong on the facts. But it's also involving these programmers and system setup people.
I read several articles on the internet on these people that are putting out this fake news, who were basically doing it for financial reasons. And they didn't have a horse in the race. They just wanted to make money. And a lot of them actually, as a candidate, preferred either Bernie Sanders and or Hillary Clinton. The problem was they tried launching websites to gin up some clicks on those two. They did not get the traffic patterns and the commercial clicks that Donald Trump's website did, because he's a TV character. Okay, he's sitting here, and he just was more fun.
Right, so let's take a quick break again, and we'll come back and talk about that, because I think we need to. We'll be right back.
Have you discovered Rockland County? It's the Hudson River Valley's best-kept secret, where you'll find beautiful river towns. Whether it's the charm of Piermont, the art and soul of Nyack, the history of Stony Point, or the allure of Havistraw, you'll find them all in Rockland County. Start discovering the Rockland River Towns. Visit rocklandrivertowns.org to plan your trip today.
Welcome back to the Voice of Reason. We're going to wrap up this topic of fake news. And so I just wanted to toss it to you, Paul, to start. What do you think the consequences are of where we are now with this issue?
Well, I would say, certainly for the past 20 years, even if not more, TV news has been a farce. It's been a total farce. I mean, there's been stuff going out in the world that we totally ignore, and we are only working on the little bits of news that they want us to know about. The consequences of that has been that I do not any longer look at TV news. I don't believe it. I have no faith in it. I search for my news, and I think that's going to happen more and more in this country. People are not going to listen to the mainstream crap. they're going to be searching throughout the internet to find outlets. Now, for instance, I have a number of different alternative outlets that I've been following for a long time now, and they're, every once in a while there's something questionable, and you think, well, I don't know, what's the truth in that? But generally speaking, if you've got an outlet that you know has been pretty much truthful all along, you're going to follow that. And I think that's what's going to happen. People are going to find their truthful outlets and they're going to stick to them. They're not going to listen to the rest of the crap because, number one, it becomes overwhelming. But number two, they don't want to fill their heads with lies. I mean, this is the biggest issue today is we carry around so much crap in our heads that simply isn't relevant, it isn't true, it has no purpose in our lives. So this is it. It's a matter of seeking out what you feel is the true source.
Right, so Sherwood, what I would say, that would be Paul and his response, because we know Paul, but do you think that maybe other people are just going to shut down because they are overwhelmed, like Paul pointed out?
No, and what scares me is I don't want to underplay Russia's role in all of this. In other words, if you look at a report put out at Prop or Not, which is a nonpartisan group of researchers with foreign policy, military, and technology backgrounds, they study, for instance, one report, I don't know if you remember when the whole like news was coming out about Hillary's pneumonia and she's dying and all of that. Okay, the Daily Beast put out a story that was telling the truth, okay? It got like 7,000 Facebook hits and 30,000 views. Meanwhile, the Russians, through their sausage-making machine, put out a similar story but making it seem much more dire for Hillary Clinton. And they literally got 90,000 Facebook views and over 15 million views of the article itself.
Let me ask you a quick question about that, because you've brought that up pretty much twice in this discussion. What do you think that says about the people who voted for Trump versus the people who voted for Hillary or Bernie? I mean, I guess it would say that the people who voted for Trump are more strapped to their computers and clicking through and not making discerning study and research of what they're looking for. Would that not be true based on what you're citing?
Well, you know, it's like, unfortunately, we're sitting there for starters. Let's be honest. What the Russians really gave Donald Trump was a super PAC. Okay, he was the benefit of billions of dollars worth of free advertising and free fake articles tearing Hillary down, okay? And Prop or Not literally came out and basically said that some players in this online echo chamber were knowingly part of the propaganda campaign. The researchers concluded, while others were useful idiots. I can't say it any better than that. In other words, these people were sitting there because they didn't do their homework, because they didn't bother to check to see if the story had any basis in fact or foundation in fact. They just willy-nilly started passing it around to their friends, and it goes back to the old adage of, you know, look at gossip. I tell him something, he tells you something. By the time it gets over here, the story has just, you know, mutated into this horrid thing. So I don't know how we stop it, but I do know we have to.
I hear you. So we're going to leave this topic here, and I guess the sum is be careful what you put in your brain.
Yeah.
Do your homework as a person like Paul does, struggling with all his might to find the truth. So we're going to move on to our next topic, which is the Standing Rock issue ongoing, and also we're going to try to talk a little bit about the Spectra pipeline here locally. We'll be right back.
It's not just radio, it's Rockland World Radio. RocklandWorldRadio.com.
The Army Corps of Engineers said that they're going to do an environmental impact statement and also look into rerouting the pipeline, the Dakota Access Pipeline. In the meantime, the company stepped up and said that once Donald Trump is in office, they believe as originally planned. What do you gentlemen make of that? Sherwood, I know you've been doing a lot of homework on this, so I'll give it to you.
I find this whole decision by the Army Corps of Engineers way too beautifully packaged as a Christmas present. Okay, it's a modern-day Trojan horse. I think, A, they're hoping that a lot of people are going to say, oh my God, we won, and they're going to can't pack up and they're going to go home to spend family. When in reality, the decision could change in 24 hours, and B, is more than likely going to change when Donald Trump takes office. And so I just have to caution everybody. You need to stand hard and firm. Stay where you're at. Don't let them pull the wool over your eyes.
Paul? I don't think that Trump is immune to public opinion. And public opinion on this issue has been rising up at a tremendous rate across the nation. They know now, the politicians know that, in fact, some of them were even involved in this, that this is a big issue for the people. And they can't just bulldoze over the people, because it's not just now to do with the Standing Rock tribe, it's to do with, to start with, they reckon there's up to 500 tribes now involved in this whole thing, plus 2,000 or more veterans, and across the nation, I mean, people are just angry about the fact that, the corporations have the right to just keep on bulldozing over folks, and it isn't about Native Americans anymore, it's about us. Because if they do it there, they'll do it here, they'll do it anywhere.
It does seem to be about corporate power over individuals.
Oh, absolutely. And so this is a major cause, and it's not going to just go away and be placated by one little decision like that. I think that this is an ongoing thing, and it's not going to stop. It's not going to stop until they see all of those heavy-duty equipment being pulled out of there, and then saying, okay, we give up. We're going to go somewhere else with our pipeline. At that point, maybe the thing will quieten down, but I don't see them falling for that crap, to be honest with you.
Sure.
Well, for starters, you bring up an interesting point. Don't leave till you see the equipment pulling out, and we're actually seeing the opposite of that. As an example, Dakota Access has actually set up HESCO barriers, bulwarks used by the U.S. military to defend its bases in Iraq and Afghanistan, around their construction site. They've completed the pipeline right to where they need to drill onto the river, not on one side, but on both sides, okay? They're smart. They know that the most they could face is a court battle and civil penalties if they go ahead with the drilling under the river. I would not be surprised to actually see them be as bold as to do that and deal with the fallout after the fact. And so I'm wondering, have you given any thought to the fact that even though we've gotten a big win on our part, is it going to be any good if it's a hollow win because the company decides to violate the law because of the billions of dollars they're going to make and pay civil fines of a few tens of millions of dollars after the fact?
Well, as Chief Mann said at our Thanksgiving meal, that's working in the system. Even if the system is going to hurt, don't you believe they'd be establishing their civil case, Paul, by their actions now if the company went ahead and did that? If the waters end up completely contaminated and polluted, which you know they'll be testing every day, don't you think that that would be the way to work the system, as Chief Mann had said at Thanksgiving?
Yeah, but the trouble is that to allow them to complete that and then test the waters, then you're the other side of this issue, and then it becomes a real problem, because you know that at some point there's going to be a break in that line, and there's going to be pollution. I mean, there's so many rivers now. If you start looking into it, there's hundreds and hundreds of rivers across this country that have been polluted by these oil spills.
And pipeline building, yeah. Absolutely.
And I mean, these pipelines have done us very little good, to be honest with you. And this particular pipeline, we're not even getting the oil from it.
No.
It's all going to China.
Yes, it is.
So it nobody wins.
But let me ask you a question.
It kind of destroys their eminent domain claim, I believe.
Oh, but, absolutely,
sure.
Yeah.
But what about these empty shell corporations? Like you're saying, well, they're setting up their lawsuit for later. Well, here's the problem with that. What most of these big, huge conglomerates and corporations do is here's the big company, and then down underneath them in various assorted tiers are 200, 300, 400, 500 empty shell corporations that actually hold and are responsible for, say, the pipeline. Well, then all of a sudden when there is an accident, all the profits have already been sucked up through this like chain of command to the mothership, okay? And you're suing what amounts to an empty corporation that holds nothing of any value except the pipeline that's now leaking millions of gallons of pollutants into the water system. So my point is, or my question is, what good is setting up your future lawsuit if, in fact, when you sue, there's nothing there to collect from?
Well, I think that that's the shell corporations and the corporate game is part of the reason people are recognizing the absolute powerlessness of the individual against corporate power, which I think goes to Paul's point that the more people stay aware of what's going on, the more there will be action against it. But it is a long process. What I want to make sure we cover a little bit, and you guys can contribute what you have. Our panelist Michelle Solomon is sick today, so I did want to bring up the Spectra pipeline, which is going on here and is our local pipeline that is affecting us. The governor's office, I actually called them myself yesterday to see the state of the environmental impact study at Indian Point. The people that I talked to at the offices had no information to give me. They took my address and told me they would mail me some information when they had it. I find that to be remarkable. The governor called for this assessment to be done 5 months ago, now going on six. So at the end of the show, we're probably going to be able to post some information about where you can call the governor, where you can call your state and local offices to protest this action and ask for this risk assessment that the governor has asked for. So, do you guys have anything else on Spectra that you want to add?
I mean, we all know it's a dangerous project, and if you even look at, say, the Dakota Access Pipeline and Army Corps of Engineers' various rulings on that, for instance, they moved the pipeline originally because there is a grave risk to the potable water supplies to the people at the state capitol. Okay, what and Spectra's being built less than 200 feet from a failing nuclear reactor. And, you know, I love public protests and things like that, but what I think people need to realize is every citizen of the United States, okay, has the ability to file a complaint and request for action with these various and assorted agencies. So if you as a citizen filed one with the Army Corps of Engineers, one with the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, one with FERC, so forth and so on, okay, they have to respond to those. Well, as an old environmental activist, I've realized that the best way to get the attention of these federal agencies is to bury them in paperwork. So I'd like to know what you would think of us, for instance, forming a movement amongst all these people that are concerned about Spectra to not hit them with one or two filings, but to have every single activist in the area bury them under 10 or 20 or 30 or 40,000 formal complaints and requests for action that they have to answer to in a period of 8 weeks.
You need to set up a website that would walk people through this step by step. You know, I mean, you're not going to get thousands of people out there looking into how do we do this. You need to literally take them by the hand and say, okay, these are the forms, and this is what you fill in, and this is where you send it. And, I mean, that's the way these things work nowadays anyway. So, I mean, it's just a case of setting up a website and promoting it, really.
Not completely, because, like, for instance...
Maybe we should get the Russians to do it.
Yeah, they do it better than we do.
No, but if I file a formal complaint and request for action, for instance, I have to print it up, and it has to be in the form of a sworn affidavit that I have to go get notarized. And I think therein is the trick. In other words, if we started having little small town meetings where we helped organize, cut and paste, pull one together, print it out, hand it to the person, they sign it, we have two or three notary publics there, and have evening meetings where we, 50, 100, 200 at a time, we're making what you're saying happen, but actually on a local basis in each of these little communities, so that we literally can bury these agencies in paperwork they have to address, then we will get their attention.
Well, let me ask you a question, because it used to be Greenpeace, and they have kind of disappeared from the American landscape and have, I guess, been co-opted by, I guess, what we call the Green Party. But I don't even know. I know worldwide Greenpeace is active, but it's not like it used to be, where even in the city you would run into a kid with a clipboard trying to tell you about something like this. Where are the people who are doing the things we're talking about now? And I know Michelle has a number of items that maybe we'll be able to put on our blog space, but with her not being here, where are they?
The sad thing about it is Greenpeace, Wildlife International, pick any one of them you want, they've become a part of the same fetid swamp that Washington, D.C. is, because the reality of it is all they care about is keeping enough funds coming in to fund all their wonderful little things that they think are important. So unless you're a cause that they can wrap around and figure out a way to make a profit from by bringing in thousands and thousands of new members, they might send a spokesman there to show up for one public meeting. They'll give you a little letter saying, we're behind you. And they are behind you, way behind you. They're gone. They make one appearance and end the story.
Yeah, it does seem to be some type of apathy. But do you think it's because the public hasn't supported these movements in our country? I mean, the Green Party didn't really go anywhere.
Have you looked at some of the salaries of their executive directors?
I haven't.
Is what I'm saying is, they have ceased to really have the capability to stay true to their own cause, because they're all worried about meeting the payroll and keeping their beautiful little perks in place. And so because of it, they do very little real activism at the ground roots level in little communities that are dealing with problems like Spectra Oil.
I see. So I think we're going to leave this topic here, unless you guys have anything else. But as usual, activism is necessary here. Locally, you need to act. I would recommend calling the governor, no matter what side you're on, because I actually believe that that's the voice of the people. And we're going to take a break, and we'll be back on the Voice of Reason.
I'm starving. What's for breakfast?
Guten Tag!
Johannes Brahms!
I bring you arts-enriched Raisinblums, fortified with increased test scores and creative problem-solving skills.
It's good!
And good for you.
Bobby? Susie?
Don't worry, that's just the power of the arts!
Feed your kids the arts. For 10 simple ways to learn how, visit AmericansForTheArts.org.
So, welcome back to the Voice of Reason. Our third topic today is the Trump transition. From the use of his cell phone, calling and breaking diplomatic understandings that are over 20, 30 years old, his choices for cabinet positions, I think it's a free-for-all for both of you. So, Paul, I'll give it to you first. What do you think and what do you see?
Well, every single time there's a new president, they put together a group of people everybody hates, or at least everybody on the other side tends to hate them. I hear the same complaint every single time a president goes into office. I have no idea how good or bad any of these folks are going to be. But I'll tell you one thing. Trump is the best thing that ever happened to this country. And I'll tell you why.
There you go. That's a new breaking news from the Voice of Reason.
I'll tell you why. Because this country has become so complacent that the politicians have been getting away with murder. And we've been doing nothing about it. Now all of a sudden, we have somebody in office who most of us hate and who's doing stuff that is pissing most of us off. This is going to bring about, I think, a new era, a new political era in America, an era of activism from people that would normally be sitting down watching television on their asses and doing nothing. Now they're angry. Now they want to get up. They want to walk through the streets and riot and carry banners, and they want to see things change. So this is what America needed, because we were going down the wrong road for sure, and there was nothing being done about it. Now, all of a sudden, all around me, I see people, they're pissed. They want to see something happen. So, hey, listen, whatever he's doing, like, as far as I'm concerned, he's doing this country some good.
But do you think it's good for him to be pissing us off even more by his appointments? I mean, Sherwood, give us a couple of your favorite hits here on the administration's choices.
Obviously, I disagree with Paul's statement. Okay, but trying to sort of bring us back in on topic, I'd like to talk first a little bit about his telephone. Okay, that telephone he's using is a normal telephone like you or I can buy. Okay, if you go to DSIS, okay, which is a private military website, they have special phones that people in the government are supposed to buy. There's like a general phone, there's a secret phone, and there's a top secret phone, okay, that conveniently Trump should love because it has a gold-plated cover on it. Okay, but my point is those phones have all these wonderful little apps that you can only get if you have access to the Department of Defense App Store. Twitter's not included on those apps, okay, which might be why Trump's still using his private phone. But there's a huge damage to there's a huge risk to our national security with him using that phone. So there's that. But then, too, let's go to some of the other things.
About what he's saying on the
phone. No, and that's where I want to go next. We're sitting here. Look at the China-Taiwan rift that he's created. But more importantly,
China did file a formal complaint.
They filed a formal complaint with the White House.
Department.
No, yeah. With the White House.
And the state.
Okay. Both. But we're sitting here, and what I find upsetting is like in Taiwan, he arranged for that call to happen, while at the same time, he's negotiating with Taiwan to get approval for several big new luxury hotel complexes over there. You go back to his meeting with the Japanese, okay? At the same time, Ivanka and Donald Trump were sitting down with the Japanese, you know, people. Ivanka's team was over in Japan signing a licensing agreement with a chain of department stores that are owned by the Japanese government. I don't care who it is he's seen so far, there seems to be a huge conflict of interest between what's best for America and what's best for Donald Trump. And Donald Trump keeps winning on every single one of them. I'm not interested in having a president that makes himself the richest man in the world by destroying what's been a relatively successful democracy for over 200 years.
It does seem a little despotic, don't you think, Paul, for somebody says you're real happy about Trump?
See, what I like about Trump is that he's really upfront about so much of what he's doing. You know, what pissed me off, to be honest with you, in the past 8 years is the secrecy that's been going on. That we're not privy to so much that's happening because of all the secrecy. And here's Trump doing it all out in the open, saying, here I am, I'm doing it, you know. Now, admittedly, so much of what he's doing is, again, enough to piss you off. But the fact of the matter is that he's not doing it in secret. So, I'm holding back on decisions about how this whole thing is headed because I want to see what's up his sleeve. I mean, he could be a complete cowboy. He could run this train off the tracks. But then on the other hand, he might do what he said he's going to do and shake everything up and make big changes and changes, you know. If he leaves this place in a mess, the next person will have something to God knows, I don't know, 20 years, he's just going down the road. And talking about nowadays is the power of the globalists, the people that are really running the world. They're calling the shots everywhere. Trump is not on their team. And that alone is one of the reasons why I think he's got a chance of doing something worthwhile, even if he does it in a very haphazard and clumsy way. He's moving us away from the global control that we were under, which was doing us no good. It was putting all the money into the hands of the oligarchs in the world, and is leaving us. I mean, where's our middle class now? You know.
Well, no, I think he's looking at corporate people and. Well, you, Sherwood, I don't know if you saw his Donald Trump's tweet this morning, which was about the air. That whole Twitter, he was basically calling out a corporation that is government, no question about it, saying that $4 billion for a new Air Force One from Boeing was way too much money. And his actual quote when he was entering Trump Tower this morning, I believe, was, we want Boeing to be make a lot of money like every American company, but that not that much money and not for that product.
Okay, a couple things here. For starters, I'm very leery of somebody that's wanting to lead America down the pathway to isolationism. Okay, two, I'm tired of Trump misframing things in the media going along with it, i.e., let's look at the carrier situation. The headline...
Before you get into the carrier situation, let's just take a quick break. We'll be right back.
In regards to carrier, just really succinctly, the real headline of that was, is Trump gives carrier $7 million for a net loss of $1,300. That's not what we were fed. Lastly, you brought up Boeing and Donald Trump's tweet of this morning, okay? If you go to the DSIS military website, for instance, they have a secure travel kit for diplomats and things like that. Those are $27,000 a piece for a little tiny box like this. You have to remember economy of scale. When you're building like a one-off, like the president's plane, and you look at the technology that's going into that, that's only ever going to be used once for that plane, it's going to cost you a few bucks to build the most secure, technologically advanced aircraft in the world. And if you put that in perspective to say the cost of building a space shuttle, it's actually a bargain. So I think we have to be careful when Donald Trump's just coming out of nowhere with his like, oh, I need to get a good deal. Maybe we actually are getting a better deal than Trump's trying to make us believe we are getting with that Boeing presidential aircraft.
What do you think of that?
I have no idea. I mean, you know, Bill, we don't even know what's gone into that aircraft,
exactly.
Do we?
That's what I'm asking.
You're not supposed to.
No, exactly. I mean, you know, there's so much sophisticated technology nowadays, much of which we have no knowledge of, that it may cost every penny of that to create an airplane that you know, functions. I don't know.
Do you think that $4 billion is that you find that price believable? Genuinely? Like thinking it through, against the corporate things that you've talked about, do you really think $4 billion for the president's plane? I mean, the president has not been blown out of the sky in the history of flying.
Yeah.
So what does the president need exactly
well, what
to cost $4 billion?
What's a regular plane cost?
Yeah, I was going to say, why are we building a new one?
These are the questions that I'm sure we might have. Yeah,
the old one is getting long of tooth, to use an expression. It's getting old. The engines have literally millions and millions of miles on them, okay? And two, it's like, just to give you an example, you can go out and buy, say, a Lincoln Continental Town Car for what, around $40,000, $50,000? Well, a Lincoln Town Car doesn't come with 2-inch thick armor plating steel that the presidential limousine comes with. So this is what I'm saying, is we have to compare apples to apples, oranges to oranges. That's a very unique, one-of-a-kind, one-off airplane that is going to cost way more than, say, a normal Boeing 747 is. But let's say that maybe it costs, you know, I don't know, maybe 30, 40 million, or maybe 100 million or 200 million for a normal aircraft. Okay, but you're producing them on an assembly line.
Okay, so both of you basically think on the plane issue,
it's a red herring by Trump.
Okay, but now let's get into some of his cabinet choices that he has announced. The one that I found particularly surprising was the Ben Carson one for housing and urban development. What have you guys seen on his cabinet picks, and what are your thoughts about the people who've been announced?
Well, the thing is that whatever kind of history they have has to be irrelevant at this point. I know that, you know, you can say, okay, that he was a racist and he does this and he does that. If we've got a group of people that can do a good job of running this country, then let's give them a chance. However, I mean, if that doesn't turn out to be the case, then we should be out there, you know, carrying the banners and getting them out of office, whatever it takes. But we haven't reached there yet. He hasn't even stepped into the Oval Office yet. So I don't know how effective this team might be.
Well, reading people's, not even reading their past, but reading even what they say and what they have publicly professed to stand for, and I'll toss it to Sherwood. Do you not see a pattern of the things that Paul was just talking about, corporate and global?
You know, for starters, to use an old Clint Eastwood movie sort of title, okay, there is no good, only bad and ugly. Okay? we're sitting here, and you brought up Ben Carson. I mean, hello, the guy literally has come out publicly and said he believes that the Great Pyramids were built to store grain. And it just gets worse from there. You look at General Flynn, okay? The man is literally sitting here spreading and perpetuating fake news on his Twitter feed, and so is his son, okay? You have a general that he wants to make Secretary of State whose nickname is Mad Dog. Trump's picks all the way down the pike scare the living bejesus out of me. And I don't believe that we should give him a chance, because the question is how far back is his administration going to set us?
Well, real quick, I will ask this. What have you both seen in the recounts in, I know the Pennsylvania one is now federalized, and Michigan, have you been following that? Do you think there's any chance for movement in the Electoral College? I know there are several movements on to change electors' votes. I know things like the Federalist 68 has been going around on the internet way more than it had before. So do you think there's any chance for anything to happen there?
Okay, on the subject of recounts, I'm all for a recount, fine. I mean, it's great, except there should be two recounts. There should be a recount of the primaries. Because as far as I'm concerned, I don't think Clinton won. I think that was a complete false fakery, call it what you like. Somehow she managed to cheat her way into
false flag primary. I mean, you believe that?
How
do we find evidence of that?
Because
back to the fake news.
Because before that primary election. Now, admittedly, I'm only living in New York, and there's a big country out there. Everybody I know wanted to see Bernie win. I mean, everybody I was talking to wanted to see Bernie win. Now, why didn't he?
Well, they're saying she got the most votes, but Sherwood, I'll actually toss it to you. We just have about a minute. What are your thoughts on
that? Well, what I don't understand, okay, for starters, you know, we're not going to get rid of the Electoral College. It's in the Constitution. But if you go back to the Gore election of 2000, the Republicans brought up a real interesting argument under the equal protection under the law clause, okay? And I believe states like New York and California are missing an opportunity not filing a lawsuit based on that, because when you're sitting here and voters in Wyoming's power on the Electoral College are worth about 6 or 7 Electoral College votes to 1 in New York or California, that's not equal protection under the law, because our votes in large states with large populations are being undervalued, and we no longer have one citizen, one vote. And I believe we could put a monkey wrench in the whole system and stop the Electoral College from putting Donald Trump in the White House by filing a federal lawsuit that the Supreme Court would have to decide under the Equal Protection Clause of the United States.
Well, that may work for the next election, but I don't think
no, it could work for this one.
No, I don't think it would.
But I believe that under the auspices of a peaceful transition of power, a lot of people are biting their lips and sitting on their hands to have an equal transition of power, and I would rather see us have upheaval and do right by the people of America than to have a peaceful transition of power.
Okay, and we're going to actually leave this topic here, and we'll be back on the Voice of Reason with some wrap-ups. Quick wrap-ups of today's topics. We're going to start with Sherwood talking about some pipeline things that we wanted to make sure we addressed. Sherwood?
Well, A, I would caution the water protectors to be careful. I really think that Army Corps of Engineers is launching a Trojan American bald eagle into their midst. I'd also like to bring up the fact that I think the Donald Trump administration not only will approve that plan for DAPA as proposed, but I would also caution the Indian tribes and American citizens to be ready to activate in numbers never before seen, because Donald Trump and his advisors actually are wanting to privatize oil-rich Native American reservations to the tune of 56 million acres. Okay, and if you think that's hyperbole, look at the fact that one of the people now being interviewed for Secretary of State is none other than the CEO of Exxon Oil. And with that, I'll throw it back to you.
Okay, and we're going to toss it to Paul real quick, who's going to give us a quick update, finish up on fake news.
Yeah, that's fake news is a very difficult thing to discuss, because who's going to decide what's fake and what's real? You know, we live in a country where we supposedly have First Amendment rights of free speech, and free speech does include bad speech, it includes lies, it includes whatever comes out of people's mouths. When it comes to fake news, really it's up to the people to be discerning, because there's so much fake news out there. Even in when you turn your television on, there's going to be a lot of fake news there too. It's up to each and every person to really seek out the truth. I mean, we all have to be truth seekers.
Whether you got to plug it or not, you got to look for the truth. And that is the end of this episode of Voice of Reason. I'd like to thank the panel and our viewers, and I will see you next week.
It's not just radio, it's Rockland World Radio. RocklandWorldRadio.com.